morning. There we go. Thank you very much. Good morning, everyone. All right. Welcome to Mount Zion Church family. And I would like to welcome those of you who are joining our live stream service. Again, welcome to the Mount Zion Baptist Church located in Coatesville, Pennsylvania. I am Sister Miranda Sebro. Okay. Alrighty then, if you have not yet subscribed to our YouTube channel, please make sure to do so. We are continuing to ask that you share this channel with your family, with your friends, co-workers, so that we can continue to share the love of Christ and to help spread the word. Amen? Alright, now I will turn it over to Deacon Joe, who will pray, who will then be followed by Deacon Boy, who will bring us the scripture, who will then be followed by our praise and worship team. Amen? All right, let's get ready to praise, y'all.
Morning, Mount Zion. Morning, Mount Zion. There we go. Shake it off. There we go. We bow our heads and open up in prayer. Father God, we bless you and we thank you, Lord, this morning. Grateful, Lord, that you've given us another opportunity to be here, Lord. We lift you up, Lord, and realize, Lord, that we need help, Lord, and we can't do this by ourselves. So we lift up our sins before you, Lord God, realizing that they're before you, Lord, and we've fallen yet again, Lord God. But we ask you, Lord, just to continue to give us the strength to get back up, Lord. We lift ourselves up before you, Lord, realizing, Lord, that apart from you, we could do nothing. So we just thank you, Lord, just for knowing, Lord, that you have our backs, Lord, that you're there for us as we go through. Standing beside us as we go through this this fight with the flesh, Lord God. We just lift ourselves up before you. We lift up this church to you, Lord God. We pray, Lord, that you will continue to bless Mount Zion, Lord God. We lift up and thank you for Sunday school this morning, Lord God. We're appreciative, Lord, of being able to be back in school, Lord, and having students showing up. And we just thank you, Lord, just for a great Bible, great Sunday school this morning. We thank you, Lord, just for our choir and our praise team, Lord. We ask that you give them what they need this morning, Lord. And we really lift up our man of God to you, Lord, today. We're thankful to have him in the pulpit, Lord, but we don't take it for granted, Lord. We lift up his health. We lift up his mind. We lift up everything that he studied for today, Lord, that whatever word it is that you give them, Lord, that he's able to give, Lord. And we lift our hearts open to you, Lord, and pray that we can receive it as well, Lord God. We lift up those that are sick and shut in, Lord. We pray for Brother Rodney, Lord, and pray for what he's going through. We lift up Sister Carletta and them, Lord, and ask that you bless them, Lord God. We lift up all those that are struggling, those that are going through loss of loved ones, whatever the case may be, Lord. We lift up those that are just struggling in life right now, Lord. We just pray that you will just continue to give us the right things to say to each other, Lord, as we greet each other, Lord. We just pray for smiles this morning, Lord. We're just thankful for life, Lord, realizing that today was not promised. We realize that if you close your hand this morning, Lord, we would have ceased to exist, Lord. And we don't take that lightly, Lord God. So we just thank you just for this church. We thank you for this community. We lift up the city of Coatesville to you, Lord God. We pray for our state. We pray for our country. We pray for our president, Lord God. And we just pray, Lord, that you will have your way, Lord God. We know there's a lot of things going on right now, Lord, but we lift COVID up as well. We lift up those that are going through that are daily, Lord, the fight of having to deal with COVID, Lord. And we just ask, Lord God, to just give us what we need, Lord, to make it through. We lift up the seniors in our church, Lord. We pray for them. Pray for our elders, Lord. We pray for all those, Lord, that are constantly on the battlefield, Lord, doing their best for you, Lord. We lift them up to you, Lord God. We pray for the memories of the saints that have gone as well, Lord, as Deacon Tool has been on my mind lately. So we lift this family up as well, Lord God. And we just thank you, Lord. We just lift the rest of this day up. We lift the rest of this service up, Lord. We pray for those in the back that are doing work in the sound room. And we pray for those that are at the doors greeting, Lord. And we just ask that you just have your way. And we'll be careful to give you the praise. In Jesus' name we all pray. Amen.
Good morning, church family. We'd like to thank Brother Joe for that fervent prayer. Now our Bible reading should be Genesis 50, starting at the 15th verse to the 21st verse. And it reads as, when Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, perhaps Joseph will hate us and may actually repay us for all the evil which we did to him. So they sent messengers to Joseph saying, before your father died, he commanded saying, Thus ye shall say to Joseph, I beg you, please forgive the trespass of your brothers and their sins, for they did evil to you. Now please forgive the trespasses of the servant of God, of your father. And Joseph wept, and they spoke to him. Then his brother also went and fell down before his face. And they said, behold, we are your servants. Joseph said to them, do not be afraid, for I am in the place of God. But as for you, you meant evil against me, but God meant it for good, in order to bring it about as is it this day, to save many people alive. Now, therefore, do not be afraid. I will provide you and your little ones. And he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. May the Lord have a blessing for the reading and hearing of his word. Let all God's children say amen. Amen.
Change. I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need like the sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water.
Come on.
Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. It's like the sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin. It's like holy water on my skin. It's like holy water.
Woo. Oh, my skin, holy water. Hey, yeah.
I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change.
Yeah.
I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my. It's like a sound of a symphony to my ears. It's like holy water on my skin.
Good morning again. Good morning to those of you who are in the sanctuary. It's so lovely to see your beautiful faces. And good morning to those of you who are joining our live stream service. Again, my name is Miranda, Sister Miranda. Oh my goodness, Sister Miranda Cero. There we go. And I'd like to welcome you to the Mount Zion Baptist Church located in Coatesville, Pennsylvania. And I have your morning announcements for you. Amen. All right, let's continue to keep all of our bereaved families in prayer. Church family, I ask that you keep Brother Corey and my family in prayer. His great aunt passed away, so please continue to keep us in your prayers. Amen. Also, let's continue to pray for the sick and shut-in. As Deacon Joe mentioned earlier, let's continue to keep Brother Rodney and Sister Carletta in prayer as well. Deacon Joe's ordination, amen. Deacon Joe. We'll be the second Sunday in October at 4 p.m., so we are looking forward to that as well. And three ways to give. You may continue to give the traditional route, but you must be physically present in church to do so. Or you may utilize our Give Now Faith Life platform. You can go to our website at www.themzbc.org, and you can click on the link there. Or you can text the word give and your amount to the following, area code 610-708-5757. Again, that number is area code 610-708-5757. All of that information can be found on our website at www.themzbc.org. Amen?
Amen.
All right, y'all. Now I'm going to turn it over to the Mount Zion Baptist Choir. They're back, y'all. Amen. I'm excited about that. So I'm going to turn it over to the choir for some selections, who will then be followed by Pastor Henry Michael Boy, who will bring us the word on this day.
Amen. Amen. Hey. 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 Back on deck.
Amen.
Do not pass me by. You can pass by anyway, but just don't pass me by. I got my hand up. Please don't pass me by. So much work you have done for us, through us, to us. Died on the cross. Buried in the grave, but on 3 days he got up with all power in his hands. Thank God for Jesus. I want to take the opportunity to thank the choir for singing from the depths of their hearts. Getting better and better each day. I thank God for the service, and thank God for each and every one of you who play your part, because you have not been forgotten. I want to take the opportunity to thank all the members for what they did last week. Truly. Guys, it's been a blessing to us, and we don't underscore that in no way, shape, or form. So many times you have been a blessing, and we want to thank you from the top of our hearts to the bottom of our souls. Thank Pastor Hopkins and his wife and his sister-in-law for coming out. Thank God for Sister Miranda and the job that she does. And, the overhead community. And also the sound committee and lights and the ushers. And thank God for you. And thank God for our deacons and our ministers and their wives. And, truly, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice in the fact that God is in. You know, my wife says to me, every day you got to take it easy. And I'm trying to define what is easy. When you ain't used to taking it easy. Amen. It's, oh boy, I tell you. God is still good in the midst of all that we're going through. Thank God for y'all. Amen. In the book of Genesis, we all know where that's at. If you don't, my soul wonders how you made it over. Genesis chapter 50, verse 15 to 21, as we look to the Lord. Father, we thank you. We come with nothing We come naked before you. You know our name. You know our ups, you know our downs, you know our ins, and you know our outs. And right now, Lord, you know that we have missed the mark in so many ways. We come because we need you. Hearts are heavy, minds are troubled. And we know, Lord, in you, Lord, we find a hiding place. In you, we find our healing. In you, Lord, we find our blessings. In you, Lord, we find everything that we need. Right now, Lord, we say hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. God, I was just sitting there listening to the choir as they sing and just imagining in our minds that, man, what is going to be in heaven when all God's children get together and sing to you. Father, we thank you individually as well as collectively. We come and ask you to let me down into thy treasures of thy word. Speak to me, speak through me. Pray that you will get the glory. We pray for salvation. Salvation here, salvation as we stream. We thank God for our church family as we stream to them as well as our friends. Speak to their hearts and to their minds. Father, speak to us this morning that we might get closer to you and that we might have a heartbeat for you. Your word and your people, in Jesus' name, amen. Genesis chapter 50, verse 15 through 21. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, perhaps Joseph will hate us and may actually repay us for all the evil which we did to him. So they sent messengers to Joseph, saying, before your father died, he commanded, saying, thus you shall say to Joseph, I beg you, please forgive the trespass of your brothers and their sins, for they did evil to you. Now please forgive the trespass of the servants of the God of your father. And Joseph wept when they spoke to him. Then his brothers also went and fell down before his face. And they said, behold, we are your servants. Joseph said to them, do not be afraid, for I am in the place of God. But as for you, you meant evil against me. But God meant it for good, in order to bring it about as it is this day, to save many people alive. Now therefore, do not be afraid, for I will provide for you and your little ones. And he comforted them and spoke kindly to them. Amen. I want to talk for a few minutes from this thought. Forgiveness in the midst of hate. Forgiveness in the midst of hate. Have you ever struggled to forgive someone? Everybody ought to say amen to that. Over bitterness in the midst of feeling rejected and abandoned or hurt. I don't know about you, in life we all have been hurt. Somebody has hurt us and we have harbored unforgiveness. But the truth is, it is good for us to extend forgiveness. It's a good thing. It's not easy, but it's a good thing to extend forgiveness. And when we release the offense unto the hands of God, which we should, you know, some does it quicker than others. But it's always best to get rid of it as quick as you can. We can begin to make room for healing our hearts. And I found out that forgiveness got a lot to do with a lot of things. Forgiveness got to do with emotional, physical, spiritual healing. A lot of folk have not been healed physically because of the fact that they still harbor unforgiveness. They don't realize that that is one of the keys for healing. Is once you let that spirit of unforgiveness go, then healing begins. Forgiveness does not justify the person, it frees us up. Are you with me? Because that person has offended you or done you in or whatever, it does not justify. Does not make them right. It frees us up. I don't know about you, but I want to be free. I don't want to be walking around angry as they are. Forgiveness. Forgiving someone is making the decisions to choose mercy and grace over bitterness and resentment. Why should I be bitter? Why should I resent that person? Because when you look at it, we find that even in Hebrews 12:15, it tells us not to have that bitterness. Bitterness against someone who has wronged you is an evil cancer. Why carry that? Well, in the inside, you're being eaten up, withering away, when them people are sleeping good at night. And you up all night wanting them to love you. Huh? It is an evil cancer within you and will eventually destroy you if you let it. Don't let a bitter root grow in you or your church. Are you with me? Not only in you, but also in your church. You see, I'm in control of how I let folk treat me. Are you with me? It's my choice how I respond to how folk treat me. I often tell folk that you're in control of the situation. Folk call you up on the phone and they saying this, saying that, you're in control of the conversation. If you don't change your tune and your attitude, I'm going to hang up on you. It's that simple. You know, you can get mad and upset. Right? You called me. But yet you're going to get mad at me because I don't want your product. And try to fuss me out. Listen, sir, listen, ma'am, if you don't calm down or act right, I'm going to hang up. I'll at least give you a warning. I just don't hang up. But then I hang up. After you got your warning. Here in our text, we find Joseph, the son of Jacob, who had 12 sons. My first point is this. Joseph was a model of genuine forgiveness. He was a model of genuine forgiveness. He was rejected. He was kidnapped. He was enslaved. He was in prison. Although his brothers had been unfaithful to him and hated him as well, he did not understand, but yet he was generous to them and forgave them. Are you with me? They underestimated his genuineness, Joseph's genuineness, to forgive and affect and his affection for them. Look what it says. When Joseph's, let's look at verse 14. It says, after he had buried his father, Joseph returned to Egypt and his brothers and all who went up with him to bury his father. When Joseph's brothers saw that their father was dead, they said, perhaps. Here is what if. Perhaps or what if. In their minds, they have already plotted that Joseph is going to get us now. The only thing that was the restrainer was father. Because we know that Joseph had a love for the father, and the father had a love for Joseph. And we knew that Joseph wasn't going to do anything as long as father was around. But dad is dead, and we buried him, and we mourned over him. But now we're going back to Egypt with Joseph. And we realize that Joseph is second in charge. Are you with me? He's just not any old body. But he's second in charge, and he can have our heads. But what if? Their sense of guilt was so strong that they could not really believe he had forgiven them. You know how it is. Sometimes people forgive us, and we still don't believe that they've forgiven us. We still dredge it up when they said, I forgive you. And you won't let it go, but they let it go. Yeah. You know how it is. Sometimes we're hard on ourselves. God has forgiven us, but yet we cannot forgive ourselves. We harp on it over and over and over again. We continue to harp on it. Joseph demonstrated how God's forgives us and shower us with goodness, even though we have sinned against him. When you think about how you sinned against God and how he forgives you on a daily basis, you ought not to harbor anything against anybody. Look here in verse 45. Of Genesis, verse 1 and a few verses I'm going to read here. Then Joseph could not restrain himself before all those who stood by him, and he cried out, making everyone go out from me. So no one stood with him while Joseph made himself known to his brothers. And he wept out loud, and the Egyptians and the house of Pharaoh heard it. Then Joseph said to his brothers, I am Joseph. Does my father still live? But his brothers could not answer him, for they were dismayed in his presence. And Joseph said to his brothers, please come near to me. So they came near. Then he said, I am Joseph, your brother, whom you sold into slavery. Right? But now do not therefore be grieved or angry with yourselves because you sold me here, for God sent me before you to preserve life. What forgiveness after they did all they did to Joseph. Joseph still shows a model of forgiveness, genuine model of forgiveness. You know, we must be honest, transparent, that forgiveness is not easy, especially when you've been done in. Joseph's brothers, he says to him, and going back to 50:15, and he says, perhaps Joseph will hate us, and he may actually repay us for all the evil which we have done to him. So they sent messengers to Joseph, saying, before your father died, he commanded, saying. Now they setting this thing up. We know we in trouble. Right? But what you have to understand, that true forgiveness is taking place, but also true repentance is taking place. Are you with me? Not only did Joseph forgive them, but now true repentance is taking place. Because he says, thus you shall say to Joseph, I beg you, please forgive your trespasses of your brothers and their sins. For they had did evil. They sent the messenger. Some say they believe it might have been Benjamin, right? Because Benjamin and, you know, Joseph had the same mom, right? So they were kind of close. So they figured that maybe we'd send Ben over and talk to Joe about this situation. He said, now please forgive the trespasses of your servants of God, your father. And when Joseph heard it, he wept. No doubt, because I thought this was dealt with. I thought we settled this. You know, sometimes that's hard. When you think that you settled a situation and you thought you let it go and you thought that person forgave you, it comes back up. It hurts. Am I right? It hurts. My second point is this. He reject his right to get revenge. Well, that's a tough one. He reject his right to get revenge. In your mind, in my mind, if somebody did this to us, we had a right for revenge. Well, I ain't taking that. No, I'm not taking that. Not at all. I said I must be honest. Forgiveness is not easy, especially when you have been deeply hurt. Joseph's brothers hated him for several reasons. Let's find out if Joseph was all innocent in this situation. I don't think he was. Number one, we find that in Genesis 37, verse 3, because Jacob loved Joseph more than all his brothers, favoritism. Daddy started it all. Because of Rachel. He loved Rachel. And he was old. In his old age, he brought forth Joseph. Then later Benjamin. Right? So Daddy started it all. But Joseph was young, and but the older brothers were rascals. They were rascals. Daddy couldn't really trust him. But Joseph, number one, father showed favoritism. A. B, he made him a coat of many colors. Now he really rubbing it in. His father made him a coat of many colors. This coat was a symbol of authority and favor and position in the family. Now, he's the young boy, and all of them are older, but Daddy put him in charge. Now, that's a problem. That's a problem. How is it that he is in charge of all of us? Well, Dad didn't trust the rest of them. Dad spent more time with Joseph. Educated him, trained him in the word. You know, when they get older, you somewhat putter out. Y'all don't know what I'm talking about. I'm going to help you. When you raise your kids, you got a lot of energy. But when the grandkids come along, you're a little or some a little softer. Y'all know what I'm talking about? You done had all the fight out of you with the kids. Now my grandkids come, it's a little different because they can go home, right? I ain't gonna tell y'all. But then, number C, also they hated him because of his dreams. Yeah. Now listen, Joseph had dreams, but Joseph was prideful with his dreams. Yeah. He was spiritual prideful. But do you know what I understand about this dream? This dream was not for everybody. This dream was only for Joseph. You see, God will give us a dream, and it's to encourage us. It's not for everybody. Everybody can't handle your dream. They are called dream killers. Are you with me? Oh, they ain't there to encourage you. They're there to discourage you. But Joseph told it in a way that he was so prideful about his sheep standing up. Huh? Putting them down already, you know, I already hate him because how father done made him the favorite and give him a cup. And now he coming up here telling him he gonna rule over us. Your dreams you got to keep to yourself. And let God bless you in them dreams. It was there to edify Joseph, to bless him. Not for him to be prideful to share with somebody else. Right? Then there's D. He took back everything the boys did and he told them. Here's a telltale. Oh boy. Ain't nothing worse than a telltale. So they, in their minds, they had a right to hate Joe. Right? But Joseph recognized that vengeance belongs to the Lord. And we must understand that. Two things that God will not share with you. One is his glory. Two is vengeance. I will not share my glory with any other. And vengeance belongs to the Lord, saith the Lord. He reject his right to get revenge. I'm not going to try to get revenge. I'm going to let this be in the hands of God. Right? Joseph wept, then he said to his brothers also, and he fell before them their faces, and they said, behold, we are your servants. Right? He could have made them slaves. He could have sent them back to Canaan, where it was still a famine in the land. Right? After all, they threw him in the pit, an empty well. Didn't care if he died or not. So, you know, he could have been vengeful, but he chose not to. And that's where the blessings come in when we do it God's way. Amen. Romans chapter 12, verse 19 and 20, that's the one you want to read about vengeance belong to the Lord. My third point is this. I'm almost done, y'all. Seeing God's sovereignty in my survival. Are you with me? Can I say that again? Yes. Seeing God's sovereignty in my survival. Here it is. He says, Joseph said, 19, to them, do not be afraid, for I am in the place of God. I'm here because God placed me here. oh, the devil used you to get me here, but I'm here because of God. It was because of God's sovereignty allowed me to be where I am. Oh, I had some ups, some downs, some ins, and some outs, but I'm here because of God. Right? Come with me to Romans chapter 8, 28. Y'all know that by heart, but I want to show you something. I think sometimes we get this verse twisted sometimes. But we know, what do you know? All things work together for the good to those who love God, right? Who love God according to his purpose, right? All things, right? So when you look at that, the good in this text does not refer to earthly comfort. See, when we look at this text, we think that all things means our comfort. But it doesn't. What it simply means, it means being the conformity to Christ. Are you with me? He's not looking so much for your comfort, but he's looking for your conformity to Christ. He didn't promise you a bed of roses. He didn't tell you that life was all going to be good, right? But as you conform to Christ, God wants us to be like Christ, to bring forth his glory, his purposes, to bring glory and honor to his name, right? So now when you bring and be like Christ, guess what happens? All things work together for the good. A closer fellowship with God. So when we begin to conform the conformity to Christ, we bear good fruit for the kingdom. And then finally, the glorification in verse 30 and verse 30. This was God's sovereignty over the affairs of men. You see, men meant things for evil, but God's sovereignty overruled man. It always overrules man. You see, there's people that are plotting your demise and my demise. But God is in control of the situation. Now watch this text. Let's go back to the text. Watch this. Let's go back to Genesis. Watch this. He says, he says, Joseph said to them, "Do not be afraid, for I am in the place of God." Right? "As for you, you meant evil against me. But God meant it good," right? Now, look at the words in verse 20. In verse 20, you see the word evil, right? Against me, and then you see God, then you see the word good. That's not in its place by accident, nor by chance. Because evil will come, but God will show up, and then he'll give you good. Are you with me? Even though evil shows up, God. That's the common denominator. But God changes everything. I was going wrong, but God picked me up and turned me around, placed my foot on a solid rock. But God straightened out my career. I was with the wrong man, but God stepped in and got rid of him and gave me a better man. I was with the wrong woman, but God. I was broken on my way to bankruptcy, but God stepped in and turned everything to good. but God. You see, evil will show up, but in the middle, God will always take precedent. See, when the evil is done to you, you have to say, I'm waiting on but God. I'm waiting on but God. Because behind but God, good is going to come out of it. But God. My last point is this. Real forgiveness follows God's pattern. Real forgiveness. If you know a person who really forgives you, it follows God's pattern. Because God has forgiven us all, we should not withhold forgiveness from others. Realizing how completely Christ has forgave you and me should produce a free and generous attitude of forgiveness towards others. You should not hold anybody hostage when God has forgiven you. When you think about where you have been, what you have done, and God still loves you in spite of. And he still forgives you. All God has to do is close his hand and you and I will cease to live. And he's still being his right. When we don't forgive others, We set ourselves outside and above God's law of love. Matthew chapter 18, verse 21. God's destiny for us will always bring blessings and benefits to others. Here's what he did, Joseph did. Verse 21. Now therefore, do not be afraid. I will provide for you. How many of you know that even in our bad state, God still provides for us? Sometimes you could sit down and wonder why he still loves you. I don't know about you, but sometimes I do. Me and my wife were talking about and reading something, looking over something, and it's got to deal with prayer and how you sit down and try to pray and how your mind begins to wander. Right? And your focus is you're trying to pray, but the cardinal thoughts begin to come into your mind. You with me? So somebody has suggested that if you start writing them things down before you go into prayer, it would help out a lot. So, you know, whatever is on your mind, a lot of times you take it into your prayer closet. And it drifts you away from what you need to do. But when I think about this text, getting back to the text, I think about Joseph and how he says, I will provide. Now, therefore, I will. Do not be afraid. I will provide for you and your little ones. Listen, not only you. I'm going to take care of your little ones. You ain't got nothing to worry about. So you know that even though that the brothers come with genuine repentance, there's genuine forgiveness. Right? You know they had genuine repentance because they said, we'll be your slaves. You don't even have to call us brother. You don't even have to give us good jobs. We'll be your slaves. Joseph said, no, you ain't going to be a slave. Right? He says, I'll provide for you and your little ones. And he comforted them. And he spoke kindly to them. The attitude. You see, the attitude and action speaks loud. Not only did I forgive you, I'm going to show you that I forgive you. Right? The brothers were upset in the sense that they thought that he was going to repay them, but they come with genuine forgiveness because they were ready to make restitution. We will be slaves. And Joseph's response is that even though if I wanted to get you, I do know one thing, that God is still good. How can I try to get you when God has blessed me through all this? Huh? Now, just go with me for a few minutes. I just thought about this. Just came in my mind not too long ago. Now, Joseph, right, he's in second command to Pharaoh. Now, could you see if Pharaoh has a party, and Potiphar and his wife shows up? And Joe's sitting in the seat of second in command. The very one that threw him in jail and the one that lied on him. But Joe is sitting in authority. You see, just because you have the authority don't mean that you do somebody in. Especially when you look back and see where God has brought you. You know that it was the sovereignty of God that brought me here. Brought me out of the pit, huh? Took me down to Pharaoh's house, and I was in there, and then his wife couldn't keep her hands off me, and I got thrown into prison. I was there, left for a long time. Right? But then God showed up. But God. Huh? But God showed up. You think about that? Listen. I don't know about you. These are the very ones that threw him in the pit, and he was still showing them love and kindness. And that's the pattern of Christ. No matter how they try to do you in, show them love and kindness. Remember, because what it does for you, it frees you up. It frees us up. And you don't be walking around worried about this and worried about that and this and that and losing sleep over somebody who hate you. Because there's times that you ain't got to do nothing and nobody just don't like you. That ain't my problem, that's your problem. That's a God problem, right? I'm going to leave it in the hands of the Lord. And that's what Joseph did. And this is what we got to do as we rest ourselves on our feet this morning.
Is calling. Have you come to the end of yourselves? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling.
Of the church open over 2,000 years ago, Christ opened the doors. And if you're here today and know not Jesus Christ and the pardon of your sin, harden not your heart. For today is today, not tomorrow. Today is today. We serve a God that says hi, but yet looks low, knows all about your troubles and your struggles. Why don't you come, my brother, my sister? Time is winding up. It's getting late in the evening, and church plan is over. Salvation, restoration, church membership, he is calling your name. Why don't you come? While the sun is still shining, why don't you come? Last call, last call. Salvation, restoration, church membership. hope I've said something to help you along your journey. Amen. All of us need some encouraging words. All of us need the word of God. I have nothing to give you. As they said in Acts, and they said, God begging, silver and gold I have not, but such is in it I have in the name of Jesus. Get up and walk. Jesus has it all. And I pray that you have been set free today. Amen. Amen and amen. Go tell somebody about the Savior. He is still setting high, still looking low. He said, if I be lifted up, then I would draw all men unto thee. It's our job to lift him up that he can start drawing. Amen. Let us stand on our feet. It's time for us to go home. Father and our God, one that sits high but yet looks low, one that knows all about our struggles. Thank you for your omnipresence, your omnipotence, your omniscience, your mutability. Thank you for being King of Kings and Lord of Lords, Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. Thank you, Father. Now unto him that is able to keep you from stumbling and to present you faultless before his presence with glory, with exceeding joy, to the God our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory and majesty, both now and forever. Let every heart say, amen.
Let the church amen. Say amen.
Let your neighbor know that you love them. Amen.